In this video, we see the bipolar junction transistor working principle. We see the currents involved and we calculate the efficiency parameters as gain, emitter efficiency, and base transport factor. We can start remembering the diode working, which we have explained in a previous video, and later we build a BJT starting from Appian junction. Appian junction shows a large number of majority carriers P holes in the P-type region and a few electrons as minority carriers, where the concentration of majority and minority carriers are bound by this relation. Similarly for the N-type region. When a p-n junction is created, some electrons diffuse into p-type region and some holes diffuse into n-type region, creating a depletion region without free carriers, but electrically charged, thus creating an electric field and a barrier potential VBI. The electrons distribution is this, and the holes distribution is this one. If we apply a voltage V to oppose VBI, we have a forward biased junction, so the depletion region gets smaller, electric field lower, and the drift current created by the electric field cannot oppose anymore the diffusion current of majority carriers going from a region into the other. So majority carriers start to diffuse into the other region, becoming now minority carriers with this distribution. For example, electrons continue to diffuse along the P region, recombining with holes which have to be replaced for respecting neutrality from our power source, so from the metal joint. But because in metal we don't have holes as free carrier, we have electrons going out. Similarly, in N-type material, we have electrons coming in and we see a current flowing through the material. The current in the diode can be calculated as diffusion of minority carriers at the border of the depletion region. Knowing the carrier distributions and doing the derivative, we get the total diode current. We have seen that for a long diode with an IW, the holes in n-type region recombine completely with electrons, lowering the level till PN0. But what if we shorten the diode so W becomes very low? When the holes coming from the P region diffuse in the N-type, they start to recombine with electrons. But if W is shortened than the average diffusion length of holes before they recombine, we may think that not all the holes recombine the short N-type region. If we now add another p-type silicon, we create another p-n junction, but this time we reverse the bias in this junction, thus creating an electric field, which helps us to take the holes in the n-type to the p-type. Being p-type long, holes recombine with electrons, but for neutrality reason, these electrons have to be replaced from the metal joint, so a current flows through the device, and this current is the current coming from the first p-type region. So we have built a device with doped silicon PNP, creating two junction PN. One forward biased, which take the holes from the first p-type to the n-type in the middle, and the other reverse biased. If the n-type region called base is enough narrow, the holes in the base go to the last layer of p-type silicon, which collects them, and for this is called collector. So a current flows through the device and this current is generated from the first p-type region, which is called emitter because it emits the carriers. This current is controlled by the voltage across the forward biased junction, so we have a current passing through the collector terminal controlled by the voltage VEB, which is more or less this. Now we see all the currents flowing through the BJT in a qualitative way, postponing all the math later. First, we see that we have a PNP sandwich, so two junctions, the emitter junction and the collector junction. These two junctions can be forward or reverse biased. So we have four regions of working of the BJT, but in this video, we focus on the forward active zone. in which we can exploit the amplification characteristics of the device. If we don't apply any voltage, the band energy diagram is this, and we have a common Fermi level in the device. But if we forward bias JE with VEB and reverse bias JC with VBC, the band energy diagram becomes this, where the step among the different Fermi levels is given by the charge times the voltage applied to the junction. When we are in forward active mode, we have this band energy diagram. Because of the forward bias of the emitter base junction, some holes from the emitter go to the base, creating a current we call IPE, where E is for emitter and P is for the holes. The missing holes have to be replaced from the source of energy VEB for neutrality reason, but in metal there aren't holes, so electrons have to go out. Similarly, some electrons from the base go to the emitter, creating a current towards the base. The current has the opposite direction in respect to the electron's movement. Electrons coming from the base recombine in the emitter with holes, and for neutrality reason, we have to replace these holes from the VEB. Moreover, not all the holes in the base coming from the emitter recombine with electrons in the base, but most of them are able to go to the collector, helped by the electric field of the reverse bias junction. We call IPC the part of IPE arriving to the collector and IBB the part recombining with electrons in the base. Because of recombination in the base, electrons have to be provided to the base from the power source, and because of the electrons going to the emitter creating INE, other electrons have to be provided to the base. These electrons are the same electrons going out from the emitter, so INE is a current flowing between base and emitter, and it is a loss of efficiency. We are interested in the current flowing from emitter to the collector, so we are interested in IPC current. This is the part we should maximize. The holes current IPC for neutrality reason has to be replaced by electrons coming from the VBC source. Lastly, we have the saturation current of the reverse bias junction JC, where a few holes from the base go to the collector, and a few electrons from the collector go to the base. This means that we have two contributions, INC0 and IPC0, and the related electrons supplied by the source. So you can see the incoming currents are equal to the outgoing ones, where IE is this, IB is this, and IC is this one. Now we analyze all currents, but first we group INC0 and IPC0 in a unicontribution IC0, which is the saturation current of the junction JC. First we start with IE, which is composed by IPE and INE, and we want IPE much higher than INE, because INE doesn't arrive to the collector. For this purpose we can dope the emitter much more than the base, so NAE, the dopant concentration of the emitter, is much bigger than NDB, thus making the holes going to the base much more than electrons going to the emitter. We want IPE arriving to the collector and creating IC, which is composed for the major part by IPC plus the little saturation current of the collector junction IC0, often negligible. IPC is IPE current less IBB, which is the major part of the base current. For efficiency, we want IBB as less as possible, and for this reason, we want the base W narrow. We cannot avoid a little recombination in the base, so IBB won't be zero. If for some reason we raise the base current by injecting more electrons in the base, we would raise IBB, because for neutrality reason, more holes should come from the emitter. But a small increase of IBB corresponds to a large increase of IPE, so we have an amplification effect. So we have a device in which a small base current controls a large collector current. Now we see some efficiency factors. Our goal is taking the most of the emitter current to the collector. The first factor is called gamma, and it measures the emitter injection efficiency, so how much current coming from the emitter is due to holes in PNP case. You can see as I and E gets small, gamma approaches to 1. The other important efficiency factor is the base transport factor B, which is the collector current IPC divided by the emitter current IPE. We know that this factor is limited by the current IBP, which is IPE minus IPC. It measures how much IPE current arrives to the collector because of this recombination taking place in the base. Of course, we want base factor as close to 1 as possible. Another efficiency factor is the alpha, which is the total collector current divided by the total emitter current. It measures how much emitter current arrives to the collector. If we now multiply base transport factor B times gamma, we get more or less alpha, because IPC is much bigger than IC0, which is a saturation current. We see for efficiency reason, we want alpha as close to 1 as possible. The last factor is beta, or amplification factor. It says how much the collector current is bigger than the base current. Remembering this relation, we can write the beta-alpha relation. We see as much alpha gets close to 1, as much beta increases, and we have a better amplification. If we now find the relation between efficiency factors and the physics dimension of the device, we could see how to improve the efficiency acting on base width and dopant concentration. In order to calculate efficiency factors, we have to calculate the currents first. We need a little bit of math, but it helps us to understand better. We know from the Appian Junction that we can calculate the currents as diffusion of minority carriers at the border of the depletion regions. So we use fixed equation where we have to derive the distribution of electrons in P regions and holes in N region. For example, IPE is equal to the product of charge, area and diffusion coefficient of holes in N region times the derivative of the holes distribution in the base calculated at x equals 0, so at the border of the depletion region. Similarly, I and E is the derivative of the electrons distribution in the emitter calculated at xE. In order to get these distributions, we have to solve the carrier's diffusion equation of electrons in the emitter and holes in the base, where delta N and delta P are equal N and P distribution minus the constant distribution N0E and P0B, where LNE and LPB are the diffusion length of electrons in the emitter and holes in the base, so they are the lengths the carriers cover before recombining, and tau is the carrier lifetime before recombining, while D is the diffusion constant of the carriers. In this way, the equation can be written in this form. So in order to calculate I and E, we have to solve the second derivative of the electrons distribution, knowing the boundary condition delta N in XE and delta N at minus infinite. We know the boundary condition because we know that for Boltzmann statistic, the relation between two concentrations of particles is equal to the exponential of the potential energy between the two concentrations. So we know N concentration at XE. And delta N is that exponential minus N0E. At minus infinite, we have a long emitter, the delta is 0 because we assume recombined all the electrons coming from the base. The solution of this equation is this. And putting this solution in the derivative of fixed equation, we have the I and E current. Now we calculate the IPE contribution, which is the major contribution of the emitter current, and we want it arriving to the collector. This can be done by knowing the holes concentration in the base, which has not a linear decay as we approximated in the short diode hypothesis, but it is an hyperbolic function. We know the boundary condition at x equals 0 and at x equals w, where W is the neutral base, so the metallurgical base less the depletion region. The solution of the second derivative is this, and applying the boundary conditions, we get this form. Now we put this concentration into fixed equation and we get IPE current. Knowing IPE and INE, we can calculate emitter efficiency gamma. If we assume W much smaller than LB, diffusion length of holes in the base, because we want to avoid a recombination, we can simplify in this way and finally in this. And here we see that if we want gamma close to 1, we need NAE or emitter doping much bigger than base doping. Now we see the base transport factor B, which is IPC divided by IPE. We have already got IPE and now we are going to calculate IPC from Fick's law of diffusion. We know the holes distribution in the base, which is this. Doing the derivative, we get this equation in which we see that the collector current depends on VEB, the emitter base voltage, and W, the neutral base width. Remembering IPE, we can now get the base transport factor B, which is 1 divided by hyperbolic cosine of W divided by LPB, which is the holes diffusion length in the base. We see that if W is 0, hyperbolic cosine would be 1, so the base transport factor would be 1, and we would have a perfect transport of holes without a recombination in the base. W cannot be 0, but we should make it as less as possible to avoid a recombination and improve the base transport factor. If W is much less than LPB, we can simplify the equation in this way, in which you can see better that as much W is less than LPB, as much base transport factor is close to 1. Knowing both gamma and base transport factor, we can calculate alpha and beta. Beta is the gain factor of the BJT, and it is a very important parameter to know. You see that acting on doping and on base width, we can improve gamma and base transport factor, thus improving alpha and beta. Here you can see the current voltage characteristic of the BJT. This is for an NPN transistor, but for a PNP it changes just the direction of the current and the voltage. You can see the saturation region, the cutoff region, and especially the active region, in which a variation of 20 microamperes in the base current causes a variation of 20 milliamperes in the collector current, so a good amplification. Here, we can see also that if the voltage between emitter and collector VCE increases, the collector current increases a little, so the lines aren't parallel. We can see it better in this diagram. The lines are inclined like a resistive behavior and not a transistor one, so we want to avoid this effect. The problem is the base width. Because when we increase VCE, most of the voltage drops on the collector junction, which is reverse biased. This means that the depletion region expands in the collector and in the base, so the neutral base W shortens, and we remember that collector current is related to the inversion of hyperbolic sine of W divided by LB. If W shortens, hyperbolic sine shortens, and collector current increases. So we have this resistive effect in which if VCE increases, IC increases as well. So what we can do? We cannot reduce the base too much, and a way to avoid the base reduction is doping the collector less than the base, because the total charge of the depletion region in the collector has to be equal to the total charge of the depletion region in the base. Therefore, if the collector region is less doped than the base, the depletion region extends predominantly in the collector, and the base shrinks less, thus the collector current shrinks less. So in a BJT we want an emitter strongly doped, a base less doped, but in any case more doped than the collector region. So there are these limits in the doping of the base. This effect is called early effect, and the early voltage is the crossing point of all lines, as you can see in the diagram. We want this voltage as big as possible because it affects our collector current and our gain also in this way, introducing a resistive effect we want to avoid.
Please leave me a comment and let me know if you liked this video. Make sure you put that thumb up, click the notification bell, and subscribe to my channel.